So I finally finished reading Fire and Blood. Well, about 3 months ago. I've been meaning to do a first impressions video for quite a while, but between going home for the holidays, getting the winter fever myself, and finishing up the first draft of a novel, this video ended up in the back burner. I finally have the time, so let's crack into it. Before we start, if you didn't watch the video I made the day of the book's release, I highly recommend you do so before watching this video. I discuss my hopes and anticipations for the book, and I feel an understanding of those will help substantiate the opinions I'll be discussing today. Without further ado, what did I think of it? Of course it was amazing. Well, mostly. Fire and Blood is a very long book, 736 pages to be exact. It's divided into different sections covering different eras in the early history of the Targaryen occupation of Westeros. In turn, depending on how you look at it, it really is 3 to 5 books rolled into one. Despite all of this, this book only covers about half of the roughly 300-year Targaryen reign. This length is both a gargantuan blessing and an occasional curse. Not all sections of this book are created equal. Aegon's conquest of Westeros, aside from a few new details, is pretty much ripped directly from The World of Ice and Fire, a history textbook of sorts that came out back in 2014. However, once the book progresses past Aegon the Conqueror and his children and into the long lives of Jaehaerys and Alysanne is when it really starts picking up. The novel-length section chronicling the lives of Jaehaerys and Alysanne was by far the best section of the book. George even said it was his favorite part of the book to write, and boy does it show. In this section, far more than the others, we get an engrossing narrative featuring a myriad of extremely interesting, well-developed characters. From Rhaegar Baratheon to Alyssa Farman to Jaehaerys and Alysanne themselves, these characters, despite the limit of the book's format, were so well-developed that they felt like characters from the main books that show. This section also delivered on another important front. The homework I gave you in the beginning is coming back to bite you. If you remember back to my release day video, I discussed the preview excerpt that George dropped a few months prior to the book's release. Coincidentally, it was ripped from this very section of the book. It depicted the concept that Alysanne was able to command her dragon to fly anywhere else in the world, but it refused to fly beyond the wall. This paragraph-length nugget led to an explosion of community theorization, discussion, and analysis in the months leading up to the book's release. In fact, it's still heavily discussed today. I proceeded to explain that my biggest hope for this book was that we would get more nuggets like these, small hints into the higher mysteries of the series. The Jaehaerys and Alysanne section more than delivered on this front. I plan on making separate videos on most of these, but here are just a few of the major revelations I and the community were able to come up with based on this section. The origin of the wall as a magical rather than physical barrier. The true origin of Daenerys' dragon eggs. What lies beyond the Sunset Sea in the west and beyond the Shadowlands in the east. The true identity of Quaithe. Why no one except for Euron has survived the ruins of Valyria. And a massive bravosi political conspiracy involving the Sea Lord, the Iron Bank, and the Faceless Men that extends into the main narrative of the current series. These revelations, which I hopefully will have time to give the separate videos they deserve, only scratch the surface of what Fire and Blood has to offer. This book has given a much-needed rebirth to the circular discourse that has been filling the community since Season 7 of the show concluded back in 2017. I believe it's given us more than enough material to pour over in the build-up to the final season of the show and the next main series book, The Winds of Winter. Going back to what I said earlier, however, not all sections were created equal. In the wake of the Jaehaerys and Alysanne section comes the build-up to, the era of, and the aftermath of The Dance of the Dragons. This was an immensely complex civil war between two branches of the Targaryen family. That's just it, though. It was too complex. So many new characters, factions, battles, and shifts in power were introduced in such a small amount of time that it was hard to keep track of everything that was going on. I found myself referring back to the wiki too many times just to keep the identities of the main characters of the section straight. This is not to mention the countless minor characters and plot threads introduced. Although not lacking for intriguing content, its overcomplexity made it a very tough section for me to trudge through. Additionally, the aftermath of this war is the book's final section, leaving a somewhat sour taste in my mouth upon conclusion. In turn, I'd say my trajectory of reading this book was from "I already know all of this," to "this is the best book ever written," to "I have no idea what's going on anymore." However, looking back at the work as a whole, it really is a masterpiece in world building. Though truthfully written by George, of course, the book is framed as written in-universe by Archmaester Gildane. If this name sounds familiar, this was the maester present at the Tragedy of Summerhall, which Fire and Blood Part 2 should inevitably cover. It's essential to understand that this is not a traditional novel in the A Game of Thrones sense, but it also isn't a straight history book like The World of Ice and Fire. It's filled with lengthy explanations and analysis, but also with engaging dialogue and full-fledged character development. Essentially, it rides a fine line in the middle ground as a non-fiction book written in a fictional universe. For that groundbreaking style, I give George all the credit in the world. Fire and Blood, for all of its issues, is a must-read book for anyone who calls themselves a Game of Thrones or Song of Ice and Fire fan. I can't wait to dive deeper into the revelations I discussed earlier with individual in-depth videos. With the community still buzzing, new findings and discussion points seem to be popping up every single day. I can't wait to crack into the meat of this book, and I hope you'll all take the ride with me. If you'd like to see more Game of Thrones and A Song of Ice and Fire contents of this nature, hit that subscribe button and ring that notification bell. If you enjoyed this video, feel free to share it with your friends and family on Facebook, Twitter, Reddit, or whatever social media platforms you're most comfortable with. For Game of Thrones news, theories, discussions, and even shit posting, follow me over on Twitter at @ProfOfThrones. For updates on my writing career, fiction work, and gonzo journalism, visit www.joshuaclafter.com. Thanks again for watching, and remember, the Professor of Thrones is here to teach you.